This is Ryan from Hip Hop Kings. We're here at Sedgwick Avenue in Leeds. I'm having a discussion with DJ esSDee about the Beastie Boys, RIP MCA.
DJ esSDee, Beastie Boys fan and DJ. I'm here with Ryan Maxwell, talk about MCA, Beastie Boys.
What was the first record that you bought from the Beastie Boys?
First one that I personally bought, Check Your Head. I wouldn't say it's the best album, I'd say it's the second best album. From Check Your Head, I went backwards, Paul's Boutique, and then backwards again, License to Ill, and then it all kind of moved forward, Ill Communication, and so on.
So what was it about the Beastie Boys? Was it the image, was it the music that captured you into their music?
Well, because I was skating and you had the clothing, everybody were wearing the woolly hats, everybody were wearing Ben Davis, everybody were wearing just pretty much what the Beastie Boys were, you know what I mean? It was reachable, it was something that you could look like. Their music was in all the other skate videos, all the skaters like the Beastie Boys, and they were white, and most skaters were white at that time. I know that sounds pretty bad in this day and age, but people weren't rapping who were white and actually being accepted as musicians.
What would you say is the Beastie Boys' best work?
Paul's Boutique, best album, 1989, out on Capitol. Don't really go into, you know, labels and things like that, but it's heavily sample based. You wouldn't clear that album today. And then from there, Check Your Head. And I would probably, I mean, Ill Communication is good. That's Ill Communication, for those that don't know. But I'd kind of pick out To The Five Boroughs above, because, you know, although Hello Nasty has got Mixed Master Mike on, it really features on there, and I think it brings all four of them together really, really well. It's very, very good. Very good. To The Five Boroughs.
Talk about production just then. The thing that interested me, and it's more behind the mechanics of how the Beastie Boys worked, is they drafted Rick Rubin in as a DJ into their live sets. Now Rick Rubin was obviously then responsible for their production, and without Rick Rubin, I don't think quite possibly we'd have Def Jam recordings.
True.
So without his influence, and without their decision to draft him in, it's quite safe to say that perhaps a lot of the artists who we love and listen to today wouldn't possibly exist, because, you know, their influences were the Beastie Boys. How big of an influence did License to Ill have on the hip-hop scene?
I don't think it was as accepted as it would have been today, because it kind of had that punk crossover that, you know, even things like Walk This Way, Run DMC and Aerosmith, that wasn't accepted, you know, fully by the hip-hop community, because it was that crossover rock stuff. And I think that it changed people's perceptions of white guys rapping. I think that they were a band before they made this album, so they were musicians. They weren't just people sampling records, which is what they obviously did when they got to Paul's Boutique. But this was all, it was metal, guitars, drums, band-based stuff.
License to Ill sold 40 million records worldwide. Yep. It will be the album that the Beastie Boys will be remembered for.
Definitely, because it crosses generations. And even things like Fight For Your Right To Party, everybody still plays that now, and everybody knows that now. Everybody grows up with it, no matter what age. That is their legacy, is that one album. Even though this isn't their favourite album. Paul's Boutique is the album that they wanted to make. They walked away from the record label once they'd done this. And if you read certain interviews and stuff on the internet, this is just what they class as an album of tracks, songs. Whereas Paul's Boutique is, I know I've held it up already, but that is the album that they really wanted to make. This is the album that Def Jam didn't want them to make. So they walked from that and released that on Capitol.
And I guess really that symbolises that whole movement, even though that was the most successful album commercially. It really just, it shows what the Beastie Boys stood for really. You know, this whole rebelliousness.
Yeah.
Rebelliousness? It's this whole, you know, rebellious attitude. You know, they walked away from a record label after a highly successful commercial album to do something that they love doing.
Yeah.
And, you know, rappers and artists nowadays, you know, would love to be in that position. What would you say is your most valuable collector's item?
Probably this that I've got in my hand. Picture disc, No Sleep Till Brooklyn, Posse in Effect on the B-side. Bought for me as a present, which kind of adds more value as well. But yeah, I think there's some money in that. And it's not all about money, but it's just quite nice the fact that I can have that up in my studio and I know that it's worth a bit of money. So that's prized possession. If I was to be left with one thing out of all this desert island style, Paul's Boutique, every time.
Do you think had Adam been in a different circumstance, Hot Sauce committed either part one and two, do you think he could have ever reached the heights of what License to Ill did?
No. Personally, no. I think that when you start looking at the back end of the material, as they got older, it isn't as groundbreaking. Hot Sauce Committed Part 2, it's alright, there's a couple of good tracks on it. But again, it's a bit like License to Ill, where it's an album of tracks. It's not really... I wouldn't say that all the others are concept albums by any means, but just doesn't have as much substance. And I think that not releasing part one and then releasing part two, which is basically part one, I just think it's, you know, that's who they are. They're kind of quirky, they're kind of, it's an advertising thing, it's just them being different. Spike Jonze.
He did the video for the single Don't Play No Games That I Can't Win.
Yeah.
And it was an animated video. I remember blogging it, obviously getting the PR for it. And one thing I do regret is not pushing harder for an interview. But that being said, at the time, you're quite right in saying it wasn't as groundbreaking. Yet there was something different about the Beastie Boys that stood out a mile from anything I'd blogged maybe that month. I mean, Intergalactic, as I said, that is the record for me right there. Everything about it, really. I can't say that I aspire to dress like them after watching the video, but you know, the whole format and what it stood for was just brilliant. And again, depending on what era you're from, you know, whether you've got into the Beastie Boys or hip hop from the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, I guess even the pre-2000. You can find something in the collection to relate to.
But I think that even if you get into the Beastie Boys because of your age, later on in their careers, it's kind of good for you because you've got all this stuff to go back to. You can never get bored of listening to the Beastie Boys. People would say, but it, you know, they just sound the same across every album. It's not true.
Well, that's where Adam's legacy will live, within the music.
Well, it has to, yeah.
You know, if you're a fan, you owe it to Adam and yourself to really explore the back catalogue.
Yeah.
You know, go and listen to License to Ill. It is already available, the majority of it.
Yeah. And Adam's voice kind of, well, not didn't kind of, he just did. Adam's voice got better with age all the way through the albums. You get to Five Boroughs, and that, for me, that's his album.
How did the passing of MCA affect you as a fan?
It broke my heart. Seriously broke my heart. It was like hearing that, and I know this sounds really like stupid, but it was like hearing that a family member had died. It was just, you know, massive part of the way that I've dressed over the years, the music that I've listened to over the years, the videos that I've watched, the inspiration, everything, you know, all threaded into the skating, the music, the DJing, everything like that. And it just all just come to a stop. Seriously came to a stop. Always going to be able to enjoy the music, but it's just, you know, the Beastie Boys, it's kind of the end of the Beastie Boys.
Is that what you think?
I do honestly think that, yeah, and I think that's really, really hard to take as a fan. Do you know what I mean? They're always going to have stuff that they can release, you know, unreleased material. Hot Sauce Committed Part 1 will be put out, they'll have enough material, whatever. They can always do instrumental stuff, they can, you know, they can even play gigs, but I just, you wouldn't ever see them going down the route of putting a hologram on stage. And it'd be hard, it'd be emotional going to watch a gig and just seeing two of them there. Because them three were one, and that's why I say it's the end of the Beastie Boys. What you said about the Beastie Boys fans owing it to the Beastie Boys and MCA, but I also think that music fans alike owe it to the Beastie Boys and MCA to delve into the archives, listen to the quality of the stuff that they released, watch the, you know, watch all the videos, even if you do it on YouTube, and that's the way that you find out about them. There's so much out there. And, you know, MCA, rest in peace. It's sad, sad days. Taking everything into account of what's been discussed, there's just one thing left to say, and that is rest in peace, MCA, aka Adam Yount.